folks. And you know, the world, you get to see a lot more of the world when you travel around the world. You know what I mean? And you get to see a lot of weird things going around you and stuff, and things can get kind of out of control, you know? And so I never sit down and say, God, I want to be serious and then I want to be fun. I just write, I like well-rounded records. I, through the course of a day, I go through great feelings, I go through really pissed off feelings, I go through sad feelings, stuff like that. And it's just, I like being a hard rock band, you can express all those things, you know, and that's what's, you know, and if some people think and take it serious, that's great, you know, we do. There's certain songs that are very serious. Other songs are just good time party songs, and they should be.
A very important part of Poison, when I first talked to you a few years ago, was, well, sex was real
right?
big. On the, is that still an important thing for Poison?
I don't think sex is such a bad thing. I just think who you're having it with and how many different people has to be. Obviously, back then, there wasn't a big scare with AIDS and stuff like that, you know, or at least we didn't know about it then, you know, and we were all very single then, you know, we were having a good time, and as time goes on, you also realize, you know, sometimes you fall in love, other times you find someone very serious that you want to be with or spend time with, but I think lots of people out there, I think lots of people would still love having sex. It's just who with and how often, and make sure you're careful about who you do it with, you know. I don't think all of a sudden everyone goes, I'll never have it again. They would like to have it, just got to be careful about it, that's all.
Is that reflected in your lyrics at all?
More the drug thing is kind of what we went through with Bobby and everyone like that. So it's, I take example, I'll give you kind of cross sections of songs. You take like Stay Alive, which was written exactly to Bobby and sort of about Bobby when he went through a very serious problem in his life, and I seen it happening. And he has a little baby boy now that I'm not so sure he was ready for in his life yet, you know, and stuff. And it was just kind of a big shock. And all of a sudden, he has a responsibility now, you know, and that is the way it is. And he knows it. And I think him being as messed up as he was, you know what I'm saying? I needed to say something to him. He was my best friend, and it went beyond music or anything. It was just our friendship, and we're good friends. And so that stuff is, everyday life is reflected in our music.
So one of the big things that happened in your life was CC leaving the band.
Right.
Now, we heard a story about him not wanting to tour, so he punched a wall, so you'd have to cancel a tour.
No, that wasn't true, and actually, it was. It's kind of mixed up, because Bobby broke his hand in a car accident in Florida, but we were in the middle, we were on the road, and Bobby flew home to see his kid, and when he was home, he was, whatever, I won't go into it, but he was wasted, and he had a car accident, and we were on our way shipping our equipment. We had just played in Connecticut, Bristol, Connecticut, and we were flying to Iceland to do a festival there, and he broke his hand, and that was it, you know, and we just couldn't, there was nothing we could do, and we were asked to play without Bobby, just get a different bass player. We would never have done that, so we just canceled the rest of the month.
Sorry, what happened with CC? How does such a tight partnership explode?
Break apart.
Such bitterness, yeah.
A lot of little things. Picture this, you're on the road, you're really close friends, and all of a sudden you have a little problem between you, you don't quite work it out, and then the next night you play and you don't quite work it out, and it goes on and on and on like that. Me and him, it was mostly between me and him, there was a lot of friction, and then it started to happen, you know, between Bob, especially between CeCe and Ricky, started arguing about some things that were going on, and then Bob and CeCe, and it just turned into a lot of stuff, and he expressed that mostly his heart wasn't into to writing with the band, and the way that we write our music as a band is that we all put everything on the table and we all work together and make things work, you know what I'm saying? And when you have that one person that doesn't want to be there and do that, it makes it tough to make a situation work.
Have your reasons for being in a band changed from when you first started out when you were real young to now?
For me, no. I still love writing my own music, being able to express myself through my music, and more than anything, being able to play in front of a live audience, which has always been my dream, and getting to do that is the whole reason I got into it, and I still get to do that, so, and it still makes me very excited.
What's this, your song Stan was played at the Clinton inauguration?
Yeah, we found that out about a week after it happened. We didn't even know about it, and it was, I heard that they were playing it there, and I was like, wow, that was a couple days before the song even came out as a single, so it was like great exposure, you know. A lot of people, I'm like, ooh, knock on wood, you know.
Yeah, absolutely.
So it's cool.
Okay, we have to give you a present. Want to get the present? This was dropped off for you, so we figured we'd give this to you live on the air.
Is it ticking?
It's not ticking. But it probably
everyone
smells
scatters.
Very good. There's four groups of roses for all the different guys in the band.
Thank you very much.
And they're sent to us from Rebecca. We don't know where Rebecca is from, but she's not here.
Oh, she's not.
She had them sent here, and so we want to give them to you.
Or Rebecca, wherever you're at, thank you. That's very,
those smell very nice.
Yeah.
So
I'll make sure that no one gets them but me. My greed is overwhelming me, so no, I'm just kidding. I'll make sure everyone gets some.
How much has the role of critics played in affecting the way you make music and play your music? Because you haven't been critics' darlings.
Are you kidding? You want to know the truth? Honestly, I've never, as a child, when I was growing up, I remember going to see Kiss play, and they were playing at the Farm Show Arena in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. I thought the show was unbelievable. Next day in the paper, I guess he was a critic or whatever you want to call him, you know, said that the show was horrible. And I'm thinking, well, there was 10,000 people and the show was great and everyone loved it. What was so horrible about it? Well, he didn't like it, but unfortunately he wrote for the paper. So I still went out and bought the records, and I remember reading Houses of the Holy was the worst album Zeppelin ever made, and I thought, no, it's a great record, I love it, you know, and so I've never really worried about it, and I think that obviously as a critic entitled to their opinion, yeah, you know, but I've never worried about it, and I think that you got to understand that music is simply meant to be made by the artists that are making it, and we can't change it. No matter what, even if a fan does or doesn't like what you do, that's our music and that's how we express ourselves. And how do you can't go back and change a record because someone writes they like it or don't like it. That's our music, you know. So,
but you have changed a little bit because you're writing country music now, you just told
me. Well, no, I mean, I can, anytime, let me explain this to people out there. Anytime you can play the guitar or piano or write anything, you can make any form of music. You know, a country song is you know, there's six strings in the guitar and there's only so many chords you can make. And so you can write any kind of music, and you can write, you know, Every Rose could be a country song if you put some slide guitar and dobro in there.
It's all in the arrangement.
You know, it's all in the arrangement, all how you write it. And I have, growing up in Pennsylvania, my parents listen to some country music, so, but I just do that because it's good, it's an outlet. I've got other sides to me, so I'd be lying to myself not to go out and make some other music outside of Poison that I can do.
So you wrote a song with Travis Tritt?
Not with him, for him, for him to play on his next record.
How did that happen?
I just writing a song, and I wrote two of them, and I thought they were great, and I'd heard some of his material, and I heard some of, went to see Clint Black play, and we talked about writing a song, so we'll see if it comes about, and if not, in the meantime, my most important thing is being in Poison and putting a band back together and being on the road this summer. That's it.
So you're coming back in the summer to support. Let's show the cover. Why is it called Native Tongue?
It's a piece that Ricky wrote. It's the intro to the record. It's a drum piece that Ricky wrote entitled Native Tongue, and we just called the record that. He figures his drumming is how he speaks through to the people, and so our music is how we speak to most of our fans that we don't get to meet, so our music is our native tongue.
All right, we're going to play Stand now.
Cool.
Now tell me about the video and what you tried to capture when you made the video and how it's representative of what the song's all about.
Say it again. Go slow. It was a rough night, so it's leading into a nice day here today. Go ahead. One
video,
more time.
Video, okay. Meaning, incorporated lyrics.
What? Video. The video came about down in South Central Los Angeles, where the choir is from, and we brought them in, which Richie actually was Richie's idea. I got to give him full credit for that. And we had finished the song in the studio, and Richie brought in the song acoustically, and brought it to us. And it sounded great. I wrote in the lyrics that I felt for me that I felt needed to be in there. He put in some stuff he felt needed to be in there, and that's how the song lyrically came about. And then when we shot the video, we just used all the same choir and the same people that did the song. And it was actually just a performance piece and something we just needed. It felt great to be back together and playing and be out and performing. So.
You must have very strong ideas about image because you started off with such a strong one.
Right.
And you're really bringing it down to a very, you know, straight ahead, very unglamorous look now. What are your feelings on image and video and bands?
I think that your image should be whatever it feels like. In music, there's absolutely no boundaries. If you feel like being completely glam and going off the deep end, that's great. And if you don't, you should, you know, I think that you have an image no matter what you're wearing, whether it's you're wearing flannel or you're wearing your hair teased up or not, doesn't matter. You know, whatever you feel like wearing, that should be you. There should be, you know, I always said this, I'm not going to let a critic dictate what I'm going to do, and I'm not going to let people in the music business dictate because they think that I should be categorized into some category. So,
did dressing up hurt your career?
Hurt it? I don't think so. I mean, I'm still sitting here.
Go to his house and ask him that question.
Yeah, right. 15 million albums later, you know, I'm not complaining. No, so I don't think so at all.
Thank you so much for dropping by.
Yeah,
we
welcome.
Look forward to having you back when you come in live.
Got
you play
it.
Live across the country.
Yeah, we'll be here.
And
we'll be at Kingswood in the summer, I think, and the Sky Dome in the winter.
Oh, so. You already know.
Yeah.
Oh, fantastic.
Yep.
Okay, well, this is Poison and Stand. Not much.